Be informed. SMS your name to 046-000-UMA.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، إمام الخلق والمرسلين، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. Praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him and we seek his forgiveness. We send peace and blessings on the final most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. O you who believe, fear Allah the fear he should be feared, and do not die unless in the state of Islam. Tonight, inshallah, we're with a special lecture and a special session, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted us through his mercy the bounty of being tonight with the two Zainabs, two of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by the name of Zainab. Zainab bint Khuzaymah wa Zainab bint Jahsh radiyallahu anhumah wa ardahumah. And before we even move on, the name Zainab, it's a very common name, and subhanAllah, it's got a few meanings, and I thought we'll grab the meaning of the name Zainab just so we could understand who we're talking about. We're talking tonight about our mothers, my mother and your mother, the mother that we've never seen, the mother that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَزَوْجَاتُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ, that his wives are your mothers, are their mothers. وَزَوْجَاتُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ, sorry. So tonight we're with Sayyidina Zainab radiallahu anha wa ardaha, bint Khuzaymah, and Zainab bint Jahsh. And the name Zainab has a few meanings. One of the meanings of the name Zainab is, and it's broken up, is Zainab, as in a good father. That's one of the interpretations. Another meaning is a beautiful tree with a that looks beautiful and smells beautiful. So that's another name, meaning to the name Zainab. I will begin with Zainab bint Khuzaymah radiallahu anha, and she was called Ummul Masakin, the mother of the poor, the mother of the miskin. Now there's miskin and faqir. A faqir is a poor person who can't afford to eat for about a year or so. He's a faqir. However, a miskin by definition is a person who's been oppressed, a person whose rights have been taken away from them, a person who can't eat for a day or two or three. There's a few factors involved in that. So subhanAllah, the mother of the believers, Zainab bint Khuzaymah, one of her qualities and characteristics is that she looked after the masakin, those that are in need, those that are in poor, those that are oppressed, those that needed help the most. And as she was nicknamed Ummul Masakin, she was married to one of the Prophet's cousins. And this is before Islam, before the message of La ilaha illallah. She was married to one of the Prophet's cousins, and she had a child from him by the name of At-Tufail, and they both passed away, the husband and the child, before the message of La ilaha illallah. Then again, she married another cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the name of Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Harith. And we don't want to confuse him with Abi Ubaidah ibn Amir ibn al-Jarrah, the opener and the conqueror of Asham and Iraq and Palestine and Jordan and all those countries. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reopen these countries again. Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Harith radiyallahu anhu is a revert to Islam, or a man who embraced Islam, him and his wife Zainab bint Khuzaymah. And they came into Islam at the earliest, one of the earliest families. And they migrated with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Medina. And in the Battle of Badr, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went out to defend the lands of the Muslims and to defend the honor of the Muslims and the money of the Muslims, the Kuffar of Quraysh requested challenge. They requested a challenge before the battle. So the three companions of the Prophet came out, three of the Ansar. So the Kuffar of Quraysh said, no, we want our own people, the people from Mecca. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't turn around and look for someone he doesn't know. He sent them his own blood. He sent Ali radiallahu anhu, Hamza radiallahu anhu, wa Abi Ubaida radiallahu anhu, the man that we're talking about. His own cousin again, Ali, and his own uncle, Hamza radiallahu anhu. His own blood, flesh and blood there and there, stand in front of the kuffar challenging them. So as soon as the challenge began, Hamza radiallahu anhu, within a few seconds, he killed his opponent. Ali radiallahu anhu followed suit and killed his opponent. Abi Ubaida was able to hurt his opponent. When his opponent fell on the ground, he swiped him and amputated the leg of Abi Ubaida radiallahu anhu. Then Hamza and Ali came and finished off the non-believer. So who do we have here? Abi Ubaida, the husband of Zainab bint Khuzaymah, his leg just got amputated. And back then, subhanAllah, being in the middle of the battlefield, being in the middle of the desert, there wasn't much medical supplies and advances that could have helped him out. So they dragged him to the end of the army and the battle began. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the Muslims in that battle. At the end of the battle, after the battle has finished, here's Abi Ubaida radiallahu anhu dying. He was bleeding to death. And they told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about him. So Abi Ubaida went, so he was brought to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bleeding. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed the head of Abi Ubaida on his thigh. And he was wiping off the sand of his head. Imagine a man who's about to die in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's about to go to the hereafter. He's about to leave this world and go on to the journey to the hereafter. Here he is there sitting in front of you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wiping off the sand off the face of Abi Ubaida and tears came in his eyes. And these tears were passing on and falling on the body of Abi Ubaida, the husband of Zainab bint Khuzaymah. So Abi Ubaida, imagine that situation. He was looking at the Prophet and saying, Ya Rasulullah, aradin anni. Are you satisfied with what I've done? Are you happy with what I've done? Oh Messenger, are you satisfied with what I've done? I've done it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you happy with what I've done? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began to cry and weep. And he held the hand of Abi Ubaida and he said, Allahumma shahad, oh Allah bear witness. Oh Allah bear witness, I am happy and I am satisfied with what Abu Ubaida has done. Oh Allah bear witness, I am happy and satisfied with Abi Ubaida, what he's done. And Abi Ubaida radiallahu anhu smiled and passed away. That was her second husband. And I'm talking about her husband because it gives you an idea what kind of person, what kind of environment she was in, what kind of person she was married to, what kind of household she came from. And after the battle, she became a widow, radiallahu anha. And subhanAllah, after the army went back, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Muslims victory. Back then, for a female not to have a husband, not to have someone to financially support her, someone to look after her, is a big burden for her family, for her brothers, for her parents if they're alive. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed and she married the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He offered for marriage and she accepted. And she married the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed that she didn't live for too long. In some narrations, she only lasted for about 2 to 3 months. In some other narrations are found, she only lasted maximum of 8 months. And then she, subhanAllah, passed away. And she was known to be the mother, not the donator to, the mother of the masakeen, the mother of those that are in need, the mother that are of those that need support, financial, emotional, physical, whatever it is, radiallahu anha would support them. And before you knew it, she passed away, radiallahu anha wa ardaha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions prayed on her. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went inside her grave and placed her, and she was the first of his wives to be buried in Al-Baqiyah, in Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on her and to allow us to see her in the hereafter. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make a woman follow her example and our men follow her example in terms of being the mothers of the masakeen. And tonight, as I said, we are with the two Zainabs. And we had Zainab bint Khuzaymah and her biography is very short. So I thought we can finish it very quickly and move on to Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu anha. And to give us a bit of a background on Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu anha. And I'll see sometimes some brothers or sisters sort of find it weird that her last name is Josh. It's back in those days that those names were common amongst the Arabs. They were accepted. As today we might look at it with a frown because of misunderstanding, but back then it was commonly accepted. It wasn't an insult of any sort. If in fact she actually came from one of the Arabian tribes, of the Quraishi tribes, which were very high and noble in status. And I want to talk about her household to begin with. What kind of family did she come from? Her brothers, what were they like? Her sister, her brother-in-law, her mother. When we talk about her mother, Ikhwani, we're talking about the auntie of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the sister of Safiya. When we talk about her uncle, we're talking about Hamza radiyallahu anhu. When we talk about her brother-in-law, we're talking about Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiyallahu anhu. To begin with, Mus'ab ibn Umayr, Ikhwani, that's her brother-in-law, married to her sister. Do we know much about this man? This is a man who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had gave him so much wealth, so much beauty. He was so spoiled by his family. And here he is, radiyallahu anhu, accepting Islam at a very young age. And furthermore, Mus'ab ibn Umayr was the first messenger of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He sent him to Medina. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam sends one of us today to one of the cities, a whole city that doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only a few believers. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam sends this young man to the Medina, al-Madina al-Munawwara, and was called Yathrib back then. A whole city and one man. Ikhwani, was only a matter of weeks, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened up that city. And Islam penetrated through the hearts and the minds of the people of Medina so much that within a few weeks, every single household in Medina had someone saying, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. That's the sincerity of Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Mus'ab ibn Umayr is the man that in the battle of Uhud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a big honor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him with the flag of La ilaha illallah. Today, so many Muslims hold the flag of La ilaha illallah for a few minutes, or a few weeks, or a few months, or even a few years, then they drop the flag. A sister might put on the hijab for a few weeks, and then get teased by her friends, give a few comments from her employer, her friends at uni or at school or at TAFE might tease her, so she'll take off the hijab. A brother might grow his beard or start praying at the mosque, and a few comments might come his way. Someone might block him at the mosque, block his car, do something silly to him, or he might get tested or trialed with something, and he'll drop the flag of La ilaha illallah. Mus'ab ibn Umayr was physically holding the flag of La ilaha illallah in the battle of Uhud. A battle which the Muslims didn't really want to go into, but they heard that the enemies of Allah are approaching Medina, so they had to go out and meet them to defend their country, to defend their people, their families and their kids. And here's Mus'ab ibn Umayr holding the flag, and a man, one of the non-believers, comes and chops off his arm, and the flag falls. What would you do? You're holding La ilaha illallah in your hand, and someone comes and chops off your arm in the middle of the battlefield. How many of us would even throw the flag before he comes and run? That's what we're doing today, Ikhwani. When someone is on da'wah, calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they let go and slacken off, wallahi, in my eyes, that's exactly what they're doing. They're letting go of the flag. When a sister takes off her hijab, when a brother stops doing his da'wah, when a brother stops donating, whatever it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you in terms of capabilities, and you let go of, you're letting go of the flag of La ilaha illallah. You're letting go of the flag of La ilaha illallah. Look at it that way, akhi. So he, radiallahu anhu, didn't want to let the flag fall, so he grabs it with his left arm, and he continues on. So this non-believer comes and chops off his left arm. So that the flag doesn't fall, radiallahu anhu hugs the flag with whatever he's got left of his arms, and the non-believers come and kill him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replaced him with wings. Wings in Jannah that he flies in. That's her brother-in-law, Ikhwan, Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Remember that name. Her uncle is Hamza radiallahu anhu, the commander of the Muslim army in Uhud, who was also killed in the battle of Uhud, radiallahu anhu. Her brother, subhanallah, and we talk about a person, we talk about their wife, their kids, their father, their mother, their brothers, their uncles, it really tells us what kind of person they were.
Her brother was called Abdullah ibn Jahsh. What does this man do? Before the battle began, people said, Ya Allah, bring us back safely to our families. Ya Allah, give us from the booty of war. Ya Allah, give us victory. Ya Allah, give us this. Ya Allah, give us that. Abdullah ibn Jahsh sat there and said, Ya Allah, tomorrow on the battlefield, send me a man, a huge man, someone very strong, and let me fight him and let me kill him. Then Ya Allah, send me a second man who is very strong, and let me fight him and kill him. Then Ya Allah, send me a third man who is extremely strong, and let me fight him, and let him kill me, and let him rip me up, break my nose, and take off my ears, and rip them apart. So that when I come on the day of judgment and he asks me, Oh Abdullah, why did this happen to you? I'll say, Ya Allah, it happened in your sake. So one of the companions, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he goes out in the battlefield. And he said, Wallahi, by Allah, I saw him dead. I saw Abdullah ibn Jahsh dead, the brother of our mother. I saw him dead, and I saw his body part ripped, exactly how he described. And I saw two dead non-believers next to him. And I saw his nose broken and his ears chopped off. Exactly his dua. Whatever he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, he gave him, sincerely. Exactly what he asked for, Allah gave it to him. And when he comes on the day of judgment, I'll be witness that that happened to him in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll stand witness amongst so many others that happened to him in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's her brother. Let me tell you a little bit about her sister. Her sister goes out. When the Muslims came back from Uhud, imagine you're a woman. Your father, your brother, your cousin, everyone that you know from the men is out in the battlefield. And then you hear news that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was killed. Then you hear news that so many of the Muslims were killed and they lost their battle. What would you do? You'd want to go out and find out what happened. There was no means of communication. So her sister Hamna radiallahu anha went out to find out what happened to her husband. What happened to her brother? What happened to her uncles? And most importantly, what happened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So as she's running towards the army, she's like, Ma fa'ala Rasulullah? Ma fa'ala Rasulullah? How is the Prophet? How is the Prophet? So one of the companions sees her and tries to avoid her. Then she told him, How is the Prophet? It's like he's hiding something from her. He told her, Look, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is fine. However, عَضَّهُمَ اللَّهُ أَجْرِكِ May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you patience. May Allah increase your reward. Your brother has passed away, Abdullah ibn Jahsh. She said, Rahimahullah, as long as the Prophet is okay. Then she ran towards another mob, another group, and she asked them, How is Rasulullah? How is the messenger? They told her, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is fine. Adam Allahu ajriki, your uncle Hamza has been killed. Rahimahullah. She moved on and she asked, How is the Prophet? How is the Prophet? So another man saw her and tried to avoid her. Then he told her, Adam Allahu ajriki, your husband has been martyred. Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Then she told him, It's okay. As long as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is okay. Then she ran until she saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with her own eyes. And she said, Kullu musibatin ba'daka hayyina. Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger, every calamity, anything after you is nothing. If I lose you, I'll lose everything. And if I have you, I have everything. How much love did they have for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How much care? How much care did they have for the hereafter? Knowing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive was more important to them than their own families, their own parents, their own fathers, mothers, children, and their own lives. Khwani, that was her brother-in-law. That was her brother. I'm talking about Zainab bint Jahsh. That her brother-in-law, Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Her uncle Hamza radiallahu anhu. Her brother radiallahu anhu. Her brother, Abdullah ibn Jahsh. Her sister, Hamna. Her mother, the auntie of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What kind of person would she be? She came, radiallahu anha, at the age that she was ready for marriage. Her mother went up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being his auntie, and that's her cousin, that's his cousin. She told him, Ya Rasulullah, I want you to find a suitable suitor for my daughter. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows that a lady and a young lady comes from such a noble family, is asking, she's looking for a suitable suitor. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked and he recommended the person that he adopted, Zayd radiallahu anhu, Zayd ibn Haritha. Zayd ibn Haritha, ikhwani, back in the days of the Arabs, and this is something that Islam came and tried to abolish as much as possible, the Arabs used to attack each other. A tribe would attack another tribe, take their women, take their kids as slaves and sell them. So Zayd radiallahu anhu was one of those young slaves. His tribe was overtaken. He was taken as a young boy and sold from family to family, from a trader to a trader, until he landed in the hands of Khadija radiallahu anha. This is before Islam. So Khadija radiallahu anha bought him as a slave, and then she gave it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And look what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. The moment he received him, he freed him. He freed him. You're free. And then he told him, I will raise you as a son. And the Prophet, this is before even the message of La ilaha illallah, before the Prophet became a Prophet. So he raised him so good, so much that his parents, Zayd's father, went around the whole of Arabia looking for his son. From tribe, to city, and he looked from city to country. He looked everywhere until he heard that there's a man called Muhammad in Mecca that has Zayd. So the father of Zayd grabbed his brother and raced towards Mecca. And they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They told him, oh Muhammad, whatever price you want for our son, we'll pay and we'll increase it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at them and he told them, shouldn't I tell you of something even better? They told him, what is it? He told him, let's bring Zayd and tell him, who does he want to live with? Imagine you as a child get kidnapped by a gang or a mob, and then you get sold to a person that you don't know and he doesn't know you, and he raises you. Who would you choose? Would you choose your family, your father, your uncle, or would you stay with this stranger? So Zayd radiallahu anhu was brought forward. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him, Zayd, أتعلم من هؤلاء? Do you know who these two people are? He said, نعم, that's my father and that's my uncle. هذا أبي وهذا عمي. So he told him, يا زيد, choose. You need to choose between me or them. You need to choose whether you want to continue with me living, and I'll treat you the way I'm treating you, or could go back to your own. So زيد رضي الله عنه said, يا رسول الله, لا أختار عليك أبدا. I'll never choose anyone over you, يا رسول الله. Oh Muhammad, I'll never choose anyone over you. This is before the message. So the father of Zayd looked at him and said, Ya Zayd, oh Zayd, انظر ماذا تقول. Watch what you're saying, Zayd. These words can make you stay with this man for the rest of your life. So he said, I'll never choose anyone over you. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to make the parent, Zayd's father, a bit happier and at ease, he takes Zayd to the Kaaba. And he raises his hand and he makes a main announcement, and he says, today Zayd is called Zayd ibn Muhammad. Today he basically made him his son. Today his name is Zayd ibn Muhammad, and today, for anyone that doesn't know, he is free. And from that day onwards, Zayd was called Zayd ibn Muhammad radiallahu anhu. Back in the Arab days, they used to, if a man locked a young man a lot, who'd make him literally his son. Who'd tell everyone, this is my son, this is, you know, so-and-so Ibn Muhammad. And basically that man becomes his son. So much so that he'll enter his house with no permission. He'll inherit from him. He can't marry his daughters. He becomes his son, literally. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the message of Islam, it came to abolish that, alongside so many Arab teachings. So Zayd radiallahu anhu grows in the household of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, raised by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet was approached by such a noble and such a good girl and a young lady, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam found no better suitor than Zayd, the young man that he raised sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, and he recommended him and he said, "Huwa khayrun nas." He is one of the best of people. And Zaynab initially was very hesitant. However, when the verses came down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirming that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam orders something or recommends something, it is a must on you. So Zaynab accepted it. Imagine marriage, and she accepted it, subhanallah. And then, however, subhanallah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that marriage didn't last too long. Zainab and Zayd just didn't get along. There were differences amongst them. Zayd was brought up in a way that was very different to Zainab. And subhanAllah, for so many reasons, that marriage didn't last long. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was encouraging Zayd to stay in that relationship. Isbir wa amsik alayka zawja, as he said to Zayd, hold on, be patient. And in that, there's a message, ikhwani. A lot of young men and women, when they get married, problems happen. And they happen between all, yani as far as I know, as many marriages as I've heard of. SubhanAllah. Whenever there's problems, listen to the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Isbir, be patient, wa amsik alayka zawja. Some young men, and even some older men, the moment his wife does something very simple, very stupid, very minute, he'll try to divorce her in any way, shape or form. Or he'll threaten her with divorce. Ikhwani, divorce is a very heavy word. It's a very dangerous word. It's not something that we should consider unless we have exhausted all other forms of resources. That's the last thing that should be on our minds. Divorce is the last thing that a male or a female should even consider in Islam. However, it is an option for certain exceptions. Isbir wa amsik alayka zawja. He's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam encouraging Zayd to hold on to his wife. Day 2, week 2, khalas, it's not working out, and the divorce takes place. SubhanAllah, one of the rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to abolish within the Arab society and within humanity is that if you adopt a child, this child can never ever be your son, because he has a father and a mother. He is not your child. You could look after him, you could raise him, you could be kind to him, you could, you know, spend as much as you want on him, teach him Islam, do whatever it is that you want to do, but he will never ever be your child. For so many reasons, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasn't specified. But so the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the wisdom of Allah has willed that this is the case in this matter. So what happens now? You got Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu anha, was divorced from Zayd. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear, no adoption. If you adopt someone in Islam, you cannot make him your son. You could look after him, you know, feed him, shelter him, or her, look after him, you know, in their needs, their financial needs, etc., security. However, you can't make them your son. They are not your son. They are someone else's children. So one of the ways to abolish that completely in the minds and the hearts of the people of that society and every other society that comes after it is for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was ordered to marry the wife of Zayd. It was a hard thing on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The man that he adopted, okay, now he used to be called Zayd ibn Muhammad. After the rule and the Sharia came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was then called back to his old name, Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu. And then his wife, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to marry her to further endorse that. And then he was married to her sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she became the mother of the believers. So much so that she used to tease the other mothers of the believers and say, your families married you after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As in, you, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam wanted to marry you, he went to your families. With me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the seventh heaven, he married me to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was a commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zainab bint Jahsh, our mother, the mother that we know basically nothing about as Muslim youth. Did you know that she was so generous, extremely generous, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the one who follows me to his wives, the one who follows me amongst you after I die first, is the one with the longest arm. So what the wives of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam do, they lined up and they measured their arms. They wanted to see who has the longest arm. So Sauda bint Zama'a, our mother Sauda bint Zama'a, she was huge, mashallah, she had the longest arm. So they thought that she's going to be the first one to follow, because it was a physical thing. However, Zainab bint Jahsh was so generous in donating. She'd donate whatever she has or whatever she doesn't have. She'd work as a clothes maker. She'd make clothes, ikhwani, sell them, get that money and donate it. Can you imagine that? Sometimes we think, well, I can't afford to donate to Syria. I can't afford to donate to Palestine. I'm not working, I'm a student. Oh, I don't have enough money. I only have Austadi. I only have my pension. I only have whatever I get from work or Centrelink or from a Khajiya from my parents. Okay, well, is that all you have really? Zainab, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to work, earn money so she can donate it. Once after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she received nearly 100,000 dirhams from Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu when he was Khalifa. Because he knew she used to spend so much. So he gave her a big lump sum, hoping that it would last with her for a little while. So Zainab radiallahu anhu placed the money, placed a large cloth over it, and she started to take out of it and put into little bags, and little pieces of cloth, tie them up, send her servants around Medina to the needy families. Before she stood up, she opened up that cloth, there was nothing remaining in it. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when he heard about that, he sent her 1,000 dirhams just to keep her going. She should spend that. SubhanAllah, she would spend so much radiallahu anhu. As it was narrated, was sadaqatu tutfi'u ghadab rabb. That continuous donation, when you donate, you're turning off the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards you. Sometimes we do a mistake or a sin, we miss a prayer, we say a bad word to our parents, we commit a sin, waliyadu billah. Okay, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. We ask that person if we've harmed them for forgiveness. We go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another thing to help with that, ikhwan, is to donate in the path of Allah. And especially when you haven't got enough money, when you haven't got so much money, donate that little money or half of or whatever you can and see how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you and put barakah in your life. Aisha radiallahu anha, the most beloved person to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said that the most beloved woman to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after me was Zainab bint Jahsh. Just to show you who she is, ikhwani, what her status was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was the very first woman of from his wives to follow him radiallahu anha wa ardaha. And then in the 20th year of Al-Hijrah, she passed away radiallahu anha. She was prayed upon, washed, prayed upon, and then buried in Al-Baqiyah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who see her in the hereafter. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our females follow her suit, follow her example, follow the mothers of the believers and all the other good examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate the pains of the Muslims wherever they are. Inni da'in fa'amminu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Wa barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Allahumma azza al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. Allahumma azza al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. Allahumma azza al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. وانصر الموحدين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين اللهم انصر من نصر الدين واخذل من خذل الموحدين اللهم كن مع إخواننا في سوريا اللهم كن مع إخواننا في سوريا اللهم كن مع إخواننا في سوريا يا رب العالمين اللهم انصرهم نصرا عزيزا مؤزرا يا رب العالمين اللهم كن معهم ولا تكن عليهم اللهم انصرهم ولا تنصر عليهم اللهم عليك بالطغاة الظالمين يا رب العالمين فإنهم لا يعجزون سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم.